Tinti. Today's Wednesday lecture series. Today we're very delighted to have Dr. Hyung Pyong Lee, postdoctoral researcher from the University of Cambridge and Seoul National University. I know Hyung Pyong from one of our common friends. It's Hyung Pyong's your new book's collaborator, Xu Mei Huang. Dr. Xu Mei Huang of National Taiwan University. She is the collaborator of Hyung Pyong's book. So that's why I knew her. And so Dr. Lee is now a postdoctoral research fellow working on the Academy of Korean Studies Fund research project Beyond the Cold War Towards the Community of Asia at the Center for Research in the Arts, Social Sciences and Humanities, University of Cambridge, as well as Graduate School of International Studies, Seoul National University. So, her research interests include typical heritage, especially in colonial and Cold War heritage, transnational heritage networking, peace building, and the role of UNESCO program in East Asia. So she has two new books forthcoming in the next year. One book is by herself, Typical Heritage in Nation Building, South Korea and Post-Conflict, Japanese Colonial Occupation Architecture. Another book is with Dr. Xu Mei Huang, Memory and Punishment, Heritage and Decommissioned Prisons in East Asia. We're looking forward to the two books. And now the time goes to Dr. Lee.
I think I had a better, just like a stand-up. Yeah, you're more... I don't know, probably it's more active than to wake you up more after the lunchtime. Thank you so much. And like, I'm so honored to be invited to this wonderful place. And then thank you, Deshimo, to invite me. And thank you, welcoming me. I just arrived last night and to finalize my Korean lectures. And I'm very honored to be here. Today I'm going to talk about how the South Korean have been responded to the Japanese colonial legacies in terms of the decolonization processes. So my topic is the heal the traumatic colonial memories. So yeah, it's kind of the like a main argument of my first book, which is going to come out next year in next January. So hopefully it gives you some idea to understand Korean, like understanding your perception towards the post-colonial period. So I graduated from the University of Cambridge, and it's a very beautiful place, but during my PhD, it was not very beautiful at the time. I was very suffering to finish my PhD. The heritage study is a pretty new discipline, even in England. So let me very briefly introduce the heritage studies. Can you recognize who he is? It's a Prince Charles. Yeah, it was young. When he graduated from the University of Cambridge in archaeology department, the heritage studies is in department of archaeology in which the Prince Charles graduated from. So the full name of the subject is Archaeological Heritage Sites and Museum Studies. So that is like a highly interdisciplinary subject between archaeology and anthropology. So heritage studies is related to archaeology, it's a tangible sites, and also history and anthropology, which is the how the people interacted with the heritage, and memory studies, how the people remember some certain place and certain past. And also it's relating to cultural geography and urban studies, but this time with a strong perspective of heritage studies, I'm going to through how the Korean government and how Korean people deal with the difficult past. So cultural heritage is the more like you can think about the palace and Colosseum, which is the World Heritage Site, and Taj Mahal, which is the one of the world wonders. So by the UNESCO definition, cultural heritage is the legacy of the physical artifacts and intangible attributes of a group or social that are inherited from past generation, maintained in the present, and bestowed for the benefit of future generation. So cultural heritage is a kind of the connected between past, present, and the future. There are so many definitions. How can we understand cultural heritage? Is a property or the inheritance from the past? Is a story or discourse or politics in the past? I'd like to say the heritage might be the meeting place between the past and the present for the future of land. So the cultural heritage, the scope of cultural heritage has been changed a lot. So the first one, there is just like a, what kinds of photo in your, like a right hand side, left hand side, just like a black and white, yeah, photo to showing the sister or brother, siblings, right? But this photo was taken during the Nazi period. So there's the young children's family, however, they are kinds of victims of Nazi. So that is a kind of just ordinary family pic photo was displayed in the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. Then the meaning of the cultural heritage is expanded from the individualistic to the like a universalized. Second, of course, from the tangible to intangible. And even under the water, then you must know about the film Titanic, right? So it's like there are lots under the water, there are lots of the like shipwrecks and some hidden treasures. So we should protect the cultural heritage under the water too. That is the St. Petersburg in Russia. The whole city was designated as a World Heritage Site. That means the cultural heritage is not only the one certain area, it's a whole an entity. And the Edinburgh, all the towns and new towns are designated as the World Heritage Site. It also recognized the process, the changes of the cultural towns is also as a cultural heritage thing. Meanwhile, previously we always think cultural heritage is always beautiful. However, now you can see it's not very beautiful building, but the site of industrial heritage is also designated as the World Heritage Site to show the achievements of the human developments. Therefore, the scope of the cultural heritage has been developed and widened. So, the cultural heritage is not a cultural product anymore. We can see cultural heritage as a social process which is always progressing and changing. In terms of if we see the cultural heritage as a social process, we also think about the relationship between cultural heritage and national identity. Heritage is viewed as one of the most powerful instruments for conforming the national identity. Heritage protects the brain and beautiful creation of the past, and also heritage plays a role in enabling people to conform their national roots and create a sense of national pride. So when you go to the probably National Palace Museum, then you should be very proud of your some certain aspects. Wow, the Taiwan achieved such a wonderful cultural development, and Korea too. So heritage boosted up your national roots and national identity. So cultural heritage is a certain form of the creation of a positive national collective identity, and also helps the construction of the cultural superiority of the national past. So between the relationship between cultural heritage and national and collective memory and national collective identity are mostly harmonious. However, if you think about if instead of the golden past, if you put the painful and traumatic past in the relationship between the cultural heritage and national identity and national memory, then how can we understand the heritage? Heritage is still positive or negative? So there are several terms to indicate the cultural heritage linked to the painful and traumatic past. Somehow we can call conflict heritage or contested heritage, dark heritage, which is widely known, and negative heritage or difficult heritage. Amongst the five terms, I would like to choose difficult heritage. When I, based on the theoretical framework of the Sharon MacDonald, who wrote about the difficult heritage, and also the Robin William and Kia Lewis, also the difficult, shameful heritage, the difficult heritage can be defined and understood as those sites, firstly, associated with traumatic and painful history events. So the difficult heritage normally is born from the traumatic and painful history past. Secondly, after the end of the past, then the site is associated with the controversies and memory conflict in the process of the forming heritage and identity in those events aftermath. Therefore, difficult heritage is like have some different dynamics compared to the other terms. So the previous harmonious relationship between heritage, national memory, and national identity has been encountered with different dynamics due to the difficult heritage, not harmonious anymore, but have some dissonance between three different relationships. So heritage always like can be think about between place, time, and people. So difficult heritage also relating to difficult place, difficult time. Then the meaning of difficult heritage is generated from the people's engagement between the difficult place and difficult time and heritage. So I'm going to move on the Korean context with that kind of theoretical framework. Have you been to Seoul before? No? Who came to Seoul? Some several people. Okay, thank you very much to be interested in South Korea. Yeah, so probably if you go to Seoul, you can see several different history layers. The first of all, if you see the very night view, beautiful night view, or the secondly, you can see the kind of globalization process in South Korea. And also in the top photo on the left right hand side, there is the like layers of the ancient cities of South Korea. And that one is the palace during the Joseon Dynasty, just immediately before the Japanese colonial period. So the Seoul has a lot of layers of the history, Korean history. So if you just visit Korea, you can see different dynamics. But that kind of different layers is also challenged by the history rupture, which is the Japanese colonial period. So you can see two different photos. First one is the Seoul panorama taken in 1929, photographed by Min Jong-sik, who is the worker of the Japanese general government. Then exactly in the same angle, in 2009, the photographer Choi In-ho, who is working in the Seoul Museum of Korea, also taken the photo. You can see how the landscape has been changing. The landscape is only for the physical landscape. Symbolic landscape is also changing. How and why? So landscape and symbolic and physical landscape has been very powerfully influenced by the shifts of power. So before the Japanese colonial period, the Joseon dynasty was controlled and by the king, and the Japanese colonial period was like more influenced by the Japanese authorities, and post-colonial period basically influenced by the Republic of Korea. So let me very briefly explain the how the Korean cultural landscape has formed from the Joseon dynasty to the post-colonial period. That is kind of your basic understanding how it was developed. So when the king of Joseon dynasty want to form the, develop the Seoul, they chose the capital as a Seoul. So the location of Seoul was influenced by the several theories, which is Feng Shui is adopted from the China, but it's different because Chinese Feng Shui is developed in the very flat land. However, Korea is very hilly and lots of mountains. So Korean Feng Shui is very strongly connected to the location of the mountain. So Korean people believed mountain have a very sacred place to give us the prosperity and the power. So Feng Shui is also influenced, the location of the Seoul is influenced by the Korean Feng Shui theory and mountain worship ideology and Neo-Confucianism and Yin Yang and Five Element theory. So king and their like a kingdoms like a very close like a scholars like a consider which place is the best for their new dynasty as a capital. So based on the kind of Yin Yang and Feng Shui theory, they finally found the perfect place. So it's like it's surrounded by the four mountains. Then they made like boundaries. So the boundaries is a kind of defense, military defense reason. However, there is a boundary for the hierarchy. Within the capital of Joseon dynasty is higher than the other city. So it's very hard to get access to Hanyang, which is the capital. So the only 8 gates is the place to enter the inside of the capital. Then they built 5 royal palaces, and considering the Feng Shui and also the red dots indicate the very particular place to serve envoys, foreign envoys. Mm-hmm. So the red dot on the, I will show you that. This one is connected to the China, so it's like a welcome the Chinese envoys. That one is connected to Japan, so they welcome the Japanese like envoys. It's also for the Chinese envoys. And that one is the shrine to worship the Korean ancestors. That is also the different shrine for the because Korea, the Joseon dynasty is the agricultural society, so worship like crops and divinity. But the kind of the very well-formed structure was consistent for 500 years, because the Joseon dynasty was very close society. They are not allowed any foreign invaders come through. So the kind of the particular cultural landscape is very firmly maintained for 500 years. However, when the port opened in the late 19th century, then the Japan invaded Korea, and finally Japan occupied Korea, then they started to construct the Japanese colonial empire. The capital that the Joseon dynasty used is also reused as the capital of the Japanese colonial empire. So open the port, the new city landscape is started, and a new road also constructed. Therefore, what had happened, like in Taiwan, probably, Seoul is a strong walled city. So the inside the wall, there are very strong Korean tradition. But when the Japan constructed the Japanese colony, modern culture, so the Seoul became a center of many conflicts between Korean tradition and Japanese modernization. So let me very briefly explain. So Hanyang Wall was mostly demolished in order because the Japan wanted to expand the Seoul the boundary, therefore they demolished. And Sazi altar, I explained the national altar to the state divinity, like to worship the god of crops, then agricultural thing, it becomes park. So it was very sacred place during the Joseon dynasty, but it becomes a public park. The royal ancestral shrine was damaged, and Gyeongbokgung Palace is a turn to the Japanese government general building. Then Changdeokgung was damaged, and Changgyeonggung also used the Jew and Botanic Garden. And Gyeongwon-gung is park, and Gyeonggi-gung used the middle school. So kinds of those are like the least the places are as of the royal places, and kinds of the symbolize the Korean roots and Korean identity in a royal, as a royal family, that were damaged and destroyed by the Japanese colonial period. Of course, Japanese colonial like authorities had a kind of reason because they want to open up that kind of place to the public, but from the Korean perspective, it's kind of a bit disrespectful, like action, so there's some different like a conflict. So in between the kinds of the cultural landscape of the Joseon dynasty, the Japanese colonial empire constructed four different like political buildings. You can see, so some the buildings are near the royal places. The yellow dots is indicating the cultural and education building. And purple dot is indicates the economy industrial building. The religious building, like the Shinto shrines, were built in the mountain arm. So after the construction, Korea was liberated from South Korea, the Japan in 1945. However, unfortunately, immediately after the end of the Second World War, the Korea was divided into two countries, North and South Korea. And also, the Korea has to support from the Korean War and lots of poverty and military dictatorship too. However, in the 1960s and 70s, Korea achieved the miracles of Rebohan. Then the economic development is like shows how the Korean people have been worked so hard to overcome the kinds of difficulties. Then finally, if you come to Korea and you can see how it's a bit cosmopolitan and metropolitan cities now. Amongst the various like interesting cases, I particularly choose four different cases. Tadepon Prison is a political one. The Japanese government general building is also a political one. The third one is the Grand Shrine of Joseon, which is a religious one. The fourth one is the Dongdaemun Stadium, is a, like a cultural and educational one. The reason is that four is a very influential during the colonial period. Meanwhile, the location of four different like cases have a strong like conflicts between tradition and modernization. Therefore, you can see how the different dynamics happened after the liberation. So that's why I choose four different cases studies. Firstly, I will bring you to the Suleiman Prison first. Okay, Suleiman Prison is one of the representative dark tourism sites in South Korea. It is located here. That location is very significant. I will explain it. So there is a Seoul wall inside, but just outside of Seoul wall. But why is important? So when Japan started to interact with the Korean policy, Japan really needed some modern controlling system.
So, because the sudden rise of the anti-Japanese movement, they are called royal troops. Have you watched the drama Eternal Sunshine? It's a Korean drama which is also released in South Taiwan maybe, but you can watch it. It's a kind of story of the royal troops. So this anti-Japanese movement in the early 20th century, which is the kind of prototype of the independent movement in afterwards. Because of the strong, like, struggles against the Japanese authorities, they really need the prison. Previously, this place is the place for the Muagan and Yeongmun. That Yeongmun literally welcoming it for obligation, or welcoming the grace of China. And Muagan is the house that admires China. So, did you remember that I explained that where the Chinese envoys stayed there, in the west side, is connected to the big road to the China? So, when Chinese envoys come through, visited the Joseon Dynasty's king, then they need some rest just before coming enter the capital. So, there's a welcoming gate, that is a kind of guest house, it's kind of very luxurious hotel, must be. So that is a place to emphasize the superiority of China from Korea. But during the Dian Empire, which is a very short period between Joseon Dynasty and Japanese colonial period, the King Gojong really wanted to emphasize the Korean independence and power. So they decide to demolish the Muagan and Yeongmun. And instead, they want to establish the Korean independence. So they built up Korean Independence Gate and Korean Independence Hall. So symbolic size. So previously, you can see the layers. The first of all, during the Joseon Dynasty, this place was the symbol of Chinese superior on Korea. Secondly, that during the Dian Empire, which is very short period, the symbol of Korea's independence, but during the Japanese occupation, that becomes a symbol of Japanese authority because they built the Sobibun prison here. It was constructed in 1908. It's probably the 500 prisoners are accommodated here. But in the end of the colonial period, it's a 3,000 one, so you can see how the prison has been grown due to the rise of the number of the independent people. So there are so many researches how the independent activists struggled against the Japanese colonial authorities. However, this time I would like to show what is the physical structures controlled the prisoners. So Japanese authorities built the Sobibun prison. Inside the prison, they used the panopticon system. But outside the prison, they want to instill and fear and violence not only for the prisoners but also to the people who pass by the prison. Therefore, they use the three different structures. Panopticon system, you might know about it. It's according to the book Discipline and Punish, written by Michael Foucault, he talk about the panopticon is such a green building. It's a power control system. Basically like this. It's the Jeremy Bentham, the English philosopher Jeremy Bentham designed the panopticon for the a more effective way of controlling people. So the wardens in the middle, he could see the 10 different people, so it's been more effective to control the people. So there is some tower in the middle of the prison, then it's easier to check how prisoners work. So they always control from the upper state upper buildings to the down, and also there is the playground to exercise. The prisoners should do some exercise, right? They are human beings. However, you can see the similar karate consistent controlling tower here, and they are all the divided like walls, because the prisoners who are in Southern prison are independent activists. So they are always like discuss something, schemes, in order to contribute to the independent movement. Therefore, in order to block their communication, they always like divided the kinds of exercise buildings into that area. So even exercise is also controlled by the Panopticon system. What about the outside? So probably, it's not that very fearful or violent. However, at the time, the Korean people's the average height is 140 and 50. It's pretty small. So that height is that wall is normally 4 meters. So very intimidating. It's very wall. And the tower, and then also you can see some kinds of sounds inside. Then people who pass by just imagine what's going on inside. That kind of imagination might have like influenced more violence and fears to the people. So maybe they are very fearful. So that kind of the rise of the fear and violence in the Southern prison. They encounter different phase because the liberation. So finally, in 1945, August 15th, the Korea was liberated from the Japan. But during the U.S. military occupation from 1945 and 1948, what's happening? So during the period. And the pro-American Korean politicians got involved with the politics. Meanwhile, in the 1948, even for a short time, there is some effort that pro-Japanese collaborators were imprisoned while the independent activists were released from the Soviet prison. So there is some certain changes. Then, 1948, the Republic of Korea was established, while the North Korean government might be established separately. Then you can see there is a Japanese colony. Actually, Japanese government general building was reused. I will explain later. The flag from the U.S. flag is to the Korean flag. So the power was changed. So then, when power changes, how was the Southern prison for? It was reused as a prison itself. However, the Korea also went through the military dictatorship and difficult period. So the Southern prison, although the power was changed, it was reused as exactly the same as in which the post-colonial period was used. Colonial period during the prison was have been used as a colonial use. So the political prisoners who offended against the military dictatorship was imprisoned here. So the kind of political prisoners, it becomes the political prisoners like a sacred place. Then in 1982, then people start to think about, because Solomon prison is okay. However, it's very unhappy to see the big prison in the center of Seoul. So let's move to the outskirts of Seoul. There is a table of some debates. So there are some debates whether they want to demolish the Solomon prison or preserve the Solomon prison as it was. So the president and Chun Doo-hwan, who is the last military dictatorship, and also And also the developers really want to demolish the suburban prison because they want to build a new apartment complex there. Then they want to get the money, right? However, the defendants of the independent activists strongly protest against that kind of decisions. And the very last minute, the president of Duan, who is the military dictatorship, wanted to do some good things for Korea. Because in 1988, the Seoul Olympic Games was held. So before, right before the Seoul Olympic Games, they want to show off how Korea was mature to protect, preserve the kinds of dark memories and dark past. So finally, the Seoul prison was decided to be preserved. However, the second conflict was the descendants of the independent activists wanted to preserve the Seoul prison as it was. However, the Seoul metropolitan government feels, oh, Seoul prison is so big. Let's divide it into two different parts, park and some certain historic sites. So there are some debates emphasizing the authenticity of the historic sites or the combining the public park and historic sites. Can you guess which one is in? Actually, in this case, the second part is winner. So it was converted into the independent park. And in 1992, the independent park was opened. In 1998, the Seoul prison historial was also opened. However, in 2008, when the director and curator was changed, they have such a deep discussion whether display of the Seoul prison historial is appropriate or not. So they have a kind of a long discussion. So how to constitute the exhibition style in Seoul prison history hall in a direct way or indirect way? Because direct way is like they display lots of washing figures using the tortures and like a blood shedding, like the washing figures. But if they remove the washing figures, then maybe they can give some more space for the visitors to imagine what happened. So kind of educational reasons, they have some debates between direct exhibition styles or indirect exhibition styles. Which one would be winner? Can you guess that? Direct. Indirect. How about the others? Okay. Then they decided to choose the indirect way. Let's see. Now it's changing. It's an independent park. So the community also used their area for the walking area and also dating somehow. The Seoul prison historial inside is a bit more direct way of displaying how the independent activists were tortured and suffered by the Japanese colonial authorities. Oops. However, now all the waxing figures are removed. Only the table and chair and some torturements like instruments are left, so people could imagine what happening there. Change it. Also, they want to emphasize how the independent activists lived there instead of they were suffered. So they wanted to emphasize their lives. So the Seoul prison was reopened in 2010. And there is one very particular exhibition place to display the card of the prisoners. So prisoners' card have their face and also why they were in prison, that kind of thing. So it was inspired by the Jewish museum. So you can feel some certain atmosphere once you get inside. So here, she is the kind of symbol figure of the independent activist, a female figure. She died when she was 16 years old. She's kind of Virgin Mary symbol, So she is a, one of the representative, like independent activists. She died right after the first March independent movement. So that kind of the prisoners' cards were displayed all the four different walls. And also, I explained that the student prison historians started to emphasize the lives of the prisoners. So what they were wearing, and then that is the kind of the bowl for the prisoners. And also, student prison historian has a, was designated as a historic site. So they still have a keep some certain authenticity. This one is an execution ground. So there's a very interesting story. That is a popular, like a tree, but that is a kind of, have some interesting stories of relating to Korean cultural like things. So before going inside the execution ground, the prisoners should be very sad. So they just lean down the trees and they cried a lot. So we can call it like a sorrowful tree called Korean Han. But the same tree also planted inside the execution ground. However, that very interestingly, the tree was very, very small compared to the outside the tree. People, Korean people explained because there are lots of the depth and dark traumas like suppress the growth of the tree. Therefore, the other trees inside the execution ground was not able to grow up properly. That kind of the story. That is a real, is that prison cells were really used. So, and also, that is the like, execution ground. But, after, although the student prison history law pursued the peace and, the peace and freedom for the next generation, however, you can see the waxing figure who are in the, can you see? So, those people just watch around. Japanese police office, they are really bad because they suppress our ancestors. So you can see the drops of the Coca-Cola. So that kind of violence though still happens. So kind of, I want to question the kind of display. Is it like a feather the people to the past or to the future?
I thought it's a bloodstain, so to arouse people's cruelty, the feeling of cruelty.
And also, there is a display of the torture, because that is the like wall torture, so the independent activists shoot us inside and they weren't able to move. So it's a very, very painful place for the as a torture. However, the young people feel like a very happy, interesting. Woo! So it's like some people felt that is a bit like a playground, entertainment. And some people see the blood stained on their desk and they feel very painful when they see. So certain kinds of visual representation, like differently interpreted by the youngsters and generations. So, just like I want to question, is it used as an entertainment and playground somehow? And also, it's a reproduction of the fear and hatred towards Japanese colonial authority. So, kind of, it's like we can see how, what is the kind of best way to the move on to the future and reconciliation. So now, after the prison, escaping from the prison, we are going to the Japanese government general building. Probably, actually, I don't remember because I didn't live in Seoul when the Japanese government general building was located, but now, it's changed, so I will explain it. So, when I explained before, Japanese government general building was built inside of the Gyeongbokgung Palace, which is the best and the first royal palace during the Joseon Dynasty. So that's why it's very controversial and problematic. The location. The Japanese government general building is located inside of the palace, and also in the palace, in the between the throne hall and then the front gate. That place. I see. So the throne hall and the front gate. That line was considered to be the most important meeting place in the place to contact between the king and his people. However, it was demolished. That line was like changed, but instead of it, the Japanese government's general building was established. So that's why it's like from the Korean perspective, the Japanese government general building is a kind of ruined the relationship between the king and people, and because the king was considered as like a big father to protect the older people, and then the Japanese government general building is a kind of block the relationship between the father and the people, their people. So that's why that kind of, if you understand the kinds of perception, it's a lot easier why the Korean people be more violently reacted to the Japanese government general building later. So there's a very brief place biography of the Gyeongbokgung Palace and the Japanese government general building. So they're a symbol of the Joseon royal power, but damaged because of the building of the Japanese administrative building, and it was reused at the U.S. military head office and also used as a National Assembly building. Then, during the Korean War, the building was used as a government building of the North Korean People's Army. Then, during the military dictatorship period, it was used as the Capitol Hall. Then, 1986 and 1995, it was reused as the National Museum of Korea after maintenance. Then, 1990s, there are nationwide controversies over demolition or conservation of the Japanese government general building. Then, 1995 and 1996, the Gyeongbokgung Palace was restored with restoration, but the Japanese government general building was demolished. So now we are going to dip into the debates between memory conflicts over demolition or conservation. So there are two groups between pro-demolition group and pro-conservation group. Probably pro-demolition group is the more nationalistic group, right? Because they want to demolish the Japanese government general building in order to rewrite the Korean history. How about the pro-conservation group? Those who are value the architectural style, and also it was used as a museum, therefore museum people wanted to keep the Japanese government general building. So there are some several groups to divide it into two groups. Two different groups have three different perspectives towards three different perspectives on the issues. First, how to perceive the Gyeongbokgung Palace. Pro-preservation groups view the palace as a national icon. The national icon and Korean tradition. Therefore, they should restore the Gyeongbokgung Palace, right? However, the pro-conservation group feels that is just merely a symbol of Joseon Dynasty. It's like now is a modern state of nation. So why do we need to restore the Gyeongbokgung Palace? So that is just a legacy of only one former Joseon Dynasty. Not very interesting thing. So there are two different perspectives. Second, how do they understand the Japanese government general building? The pro-demolition group feels the Japanese government general building as a Japanese legacy and is an obstacle hindering the succession of Korean tradition. However, the pro-conservation group people viewed the Japanese government general building as a part of our heritage because the Japanese colonial occupation period is also belong to Korean history. So they wanted to like look the Japanese colonial government general building as part of Korean history. The third, how to resolve the Japanese legacy in Korea. They also have a different perspective. The pro-conservation, pro-demolition group feels should be erased, we should erase the Japanese legacy, which is the most appropriate way to set history straight, and believing that Korean history has been distorted and damaged by the Japanese authorities. However, the pro-conservation group feels, the Japanese government general building should be used for the educational purpose, just as comparable sites were made use of in other countries, like Auschwitz. So there are some kinds of debates. There are very, very strong debates between two different groups. However, the first civilian president called Kim Yong-sam really wanted to demolish that building. So in order to persuade the public to follow their decision, he used a feng shui rhetoric.